This is Aves from RIS. We're doing tutorials on Unit 13, which is electrostatics. When we discuss the term electrostatics, we're actually trying to describe two different things. Statics being at rest, that is what we know from kinematics. And electro means a reference to electrical energy. So, energy which is electrical in nature, or corresponds to electrical subatomic particles which are charged, and by charge we mean energy which can be both positive in terms of protons, or negative if we're discussing electrons, right? So we have two types of electrical energies, negative and positive. So when we're trying to discuss these energies, we usually associate them as point charges, right? Consider these are point charges. They have no masses, but they are charged. They have energy, right? These are particles of energy, one being positive and other being negative. So when we're talking about electrical charge, we are trying to consider the fact that these are produced when electrons jump from one point to another. Let's say if you want to create a positive charge, this is an object from which if we take away the electrons, there will be a positive charge left, right? And if we're trying to consider a negative object, negatively charged object, then we mean that this electron, let's say, entered this object. So this would create charges. So this is positively charged and this is negatively charged, right? So this is just the understanding of what electrostatic is, right? How these charges are created, how these are produced, how they move around, or how they interact with the rest of the environment, this is what we're going to discuss. Let's start with topic 13.1. which is actually on the production of charges. How can we understand that these charges do exist, right? So we are at 13.1, which is production of charges. So right, so consider a fact that I have a plastic rod, right? I take a silk cloth, right? This is silk cloth and this is plastic rod, right? So when we take these two together and we rub them, that means there is going to be friction between them as we are rubbing two surfaces. What will happen? That the rod is going to get positively charged, or in terms of you can say if this is a glass rod, this would get positively charged. If this is a plastic rod, this is going to get negatively charged. Obviously, what has happened that the electrons from the silk cloth has jumped towards the plastic rod, and because of the friction, these charges are now sustained on the plastic rod, right? This is how we produced, and the phenomenon which we're using is actually friction. We use friction to do so. Friction provides enough energy in the electrons of the silk cloth to jump from it and cling on to the plastic rod, right? Friction is providing the necessary energy for the particles like electrons or protons to get energized, and then definitely jumps. Electrons jump from silk cloth to plastic rod, and hence the plastic rod is now charged. So this is how we can create charges. Let's say if we have a glass rod, right? And we rub the glass rod with cloth again. We will this time now see a different phenomenon, that the glass rod is positively charged. And why? Because this time the electrons jumped from the glass rod into the silk cloth. Why? Because it was much easier for the electrons on the glass rod to get energized due to friction and jump off from the glass rod into the cloth, right? Now you can take silk cloth, you can take fur, you can take cotton, you can take any other polymeric nylon or any other fabric that you can find to do this experiment. You'll find that due to rubbing of a cloth over an object is going to create friction, and because of that friction, energy will be produced, and that energy is going to get these electrons in the cloth or the object to get excited, and they can then now jump from one place to the other, and that is how you create charge, right? And this means this is the loss of electron, right? In the case of the plastic rod, where we had negative charge, electrons and jumped into the rod, right? So this is how we can produce charges. Now one thing is very phenomenal about these charges, that being positive and being negative has a very unique purpose, right? Let's see what happens to these charges when we produce them. Consider that we have a positive charge, right? And we have another one, which is a negative charge over here. We would find that the forces of attraction repulsion are directed from this way, right? The force of the electrostatic force will always originate from the positive towards the negative. And being opposite poles, we need to understand that negative charges try to attract other objects. Everything falls into the positive charge, while the positive charge, the negative charge, while the positive charge tries to create a field, while the negative charge tries to absorb the field, right? Consider that this arrow represents the electrostatic field created by this positive charge, right? So whenever there's a charge, we use the word field, and the field is where we can feel or experience a force, right? That is what we call as a force field. This is the place, this is the region in which we can experience a force created by this positive charge. Let's say if I bring another point positive charge, then since this is also trying to create its own field, so due to same polarity, this positive charge is going to get repelled. And what will happen, this bigger positive charge, since it's more powerful, it will repel this small charge to move away from its field, right? While on the other hand, if we bring a point positive charge towards a negative one, we do know that being oppositely charged, there will be attraction, and hence this positive charge will get attracted towards this negative charge, right? Since this is much bigger, this is a very small charge quantity wise, this is a much bigger charge quantity wise, so smaller charge will get attracted towards the bigger one, and same way this negative charge is going to have its own force field, right? Let's say this was the force field. It can be bigger, it can be smaller, depends how strong the force is or how big the charge is, right? So this is how we can say these charges that we're trying to produce can interact at a local level, at a point level. And when we discuss the same thing at an object level, let's say the way we had a plastic rod, right? We had a plastic rod which was negatively charged, right? And we also had another rod which was positively charged, right? Let's say this was the glass rod that was positively charged. So now if we hang them together from a ceiling, what will happen? We will find that there's a force of attraction between these oppositely charged, and this is not the field arrows, but this is the force that we can measure or which we can see, which we can observe, and this force of attraction is because these are oppositely charged rods. Let's say if we hang two same charges, let's say two plastic rods which are both negatively charged, now there will be force of repulsion, Now they will try to move away from each other, right? The force or the acceleration is going to be in the opposite directions. Why? Because they are now same charges, same polarity, and same polarity means there will be repulsion. Same charges always repel, opposite charges always attract, same as that of magnets, right? We do know that in terms of magnet, if you have north and south, and you bring another south close to north, there will be repulsion, right? Why? Because same poles always repel. You can consider this way, that in magnetism and in electrostatics, there's a similarity that the south is actually the negative pole and north is actually the positive pole. Why? Because we always find that the magnetic lines of forces are coming out of north, and the magnetic lines of forces are always terminating in south, right? This is how it works. This is how we draw a magnet, let's say. This is how we have seen this with magnetic lines of forces, right? So this is similar to this thing. For example, if these are negative, these will be attracting other point charges. This field is going to be inverse, absorbing, and if we have positive one, then the field is going to be coming out of it, right? Let's say goes out like this, just like the magnet. Except here we have both poles all together, and in terms of electrostatics, we can separate both the negative and the positive entirely. If that way we can concentrate our field either to be positive or being negative. Here we have to compensate between both the facts that the field will always be having both positive and negative ends, right? This is how the field works. It's self-terminating in itself as well, right? This is how the magnetic poles are working. Even at a very small range, they are coming out of north and terminating in south, right? So this is how you explain the behavior of attraction and repulsion between two objects which are now charged. Now a very simple phenomenon is electrostatic induction, and this means that if you have a charge big enough, and if you have let's say a hydrogen atom brought closer to it, which has a proton in the nucleus, no neutrons, and just one electron, right? One electron, one proton. Now we do know that same charges repel each other. This is a hydrogen atom or test atom, and this is a big point charge, right? I mean, this is not a particle. Let's just consider that this is just a point that has a lot of charge, and the size of this shows that this is very powerful. So what is going to happen? That there will be a force of repulsion between same charges, and hence the proton is going to get pushed away. And electron being oppositely charged, representing a point negative charge, it is going to get attracted. Since let's say they are at such a distance that it cannot attract the electron out of it, it cannot ionize this hydrogen atom, what we will see is quite unique, that the hydrogen atom is going to get bent, right, like this, and there will be polarization, right? This is what we call as dipole, and dipole means now we have two dipoles, and these are not complete but partial dipoles, right? This symbol sigma being positive and sigma negative represents that there is not a complete charge but there is positive charge. This also shows that there is some negative charge but not complete one, partial, right? Partial means incomplete. So this is not ionized, since these are still revolving, the electron keeps revolving around the proton in this manner, but due to the repulsion of this charge, because of this presence of this big charge, the proton is now pushed away. Let's say if we have held the hydrogen atom over here, then we will see this polarization, that one side is positive and the other side of the atom is now negative. Over here we had charge neutrality. Why? Because the negative was spread out in a circular manner around the nucleus. So the force of attraction between these two were very, very distributed, uniform. Over here there is no more uniformity in the atom. The atom is now disturbed. It is partially positive and partially negative, and this is what we call as induction, right? And induction is what we mean, that a charge can induce or produce charge on another surface, but that charge that is being produced is either partial. And why this is partial at the moment? Because this is just one atom. Let's go to now at the object level, right? What will happen at the object level? Same way, if we had a glass rod that had big positive charges, and we bring another glass rod that has no charge currently at the moment, what will happen? That these positive charges will repel the positive charges or the protons inside this rod, and they will be pushed away, right? What will happen? That the negative, currently, let's say if this is uniform, we have both negative and positive charges, right? We have both negative and positive charges in our way, because this is currently neutral. Negative, positive, negative, and another positive, right? So this is currently distributed. The net charge is neutral, right? Why this is neutral? Because we have both positive and negative charges which are equally distributed, uniformly distributed. But if you bring this positively charged rod around, it will repel all the positive charges to one end and attract all the negative charges on the other end. So what we will see, that let's say if we have positive charges, big ones, right, and we have negative charges on the glass rod, if we bring it closer, what is going to happen? That all the negative charges are going to get attracted to one side, right? And this is called induction of charge. Charge will be induced on this side, right? While the other end is now going to get all the positive charges. This is called induction of charge, right? This is called induction of charge. Currently, in this situation, we had all both positive and negative. Let me just redraw in colors so that it becomes more easier to understand, right? So we have positive charges which are well distributed, and we also have negative charges, right, with the blue one. Red ones are positive, blue ones are negative. Negative, and these are now positive. So this is what has happened. Now this is having induced charge. So keep that in mind, that charge will be induced if you bring a neutral surface, neutral object closer to a powerful charged surface. And this is because of the attraction and repulsion between these charges. This is how this uniform distribution of charges will get disturbed, and dipoles will be created, which is going to be, let's say in this case, this end is now partial negative and the other end is now partial positive, right? So charge is now distributed. And you can actually calculate the number of charges, the charge on one particle can be easily evaluated as a simple value. I think it is about 1.6 into 10 is per minus 11 coulombs, if I'm not wrong. So we will discuss that in our next topic, which I think is going to bring more interest into studying electrostatics. It's a very fun subject. Why? Because later on we will create use of this phenomenon into doing several things. For example, we have equipment like transformers, capacitors, devices that we use in our daily life, like batteries. All those things were actually invented from this tiny little phenomenon of electrostatics. And this is how we have batteries in our cars, we are running electricity in our houses, we are having a big power generating systems, like hydropower stations in Pakistan, and many other power sources which run because of this one phenomenon of induction, right? Now this is it for the beginning of electrostatics. I hope I was able to give you some insight onto the chapter, and I hope you're preparing well enough for your final examinations. Thank you.